Now to growing concerns about the deadly coronavirus officially hitting the U.S.
One person with coronavirus in King County, Washington State, has died.
So it's been 2 years since the first case of COVID was detected in the U.S., and we've had a major scientific breakthrough since then. Vaccines, antivirals. Probably what's most significant in the background is genomic sequencing. That's the work that's been done by scientific labs to figure out what mutations people have of coronavirus and what those mutations do when they do infect a person. It's really to help adapt vaccines really quickly and prevent that strain from doing a significant amount of damage. I headed out to Seattle where they had detected the first case of COVID in the community to ask the scientists who've been on the front line of COVID detection and mutation surveillance, are we any better prepared?
Yeah, sorry, this question makes me really mad. I'm hoping we've learned a lot of lessons.
So we're in downtown Seattle. When I started thinking through the question of how do we assess whether or not we're any better prepared for the next pandemic, all my reporting actually led here. And basically, the reason Seattle was so prepared by the time coronavirus came along is they'd already started a project called the Seattle Flu Study. It started in 2018, and by 2019, they were doing this swab and send program where people could take a nasal swab, which you probably had never thought of doing before the coronavirus pandemic, but people were doing it here just to figure out what kind of respiratory illnesses were circulating in the community. Because they were in this position and they were doing this work, they found the first case of community-acquired COVID in the US. We're here to talk to the scientists who came up with that project and who are hopefully going to see that through and perhaps expand it.
Ooh, hair ties. Man, I wish I knew about that. So the Seattle Flu Study started in 2018. And at the time, we called this the Seattle Flu Study, mainly because when everybody is sick in the winter, they think they have the flu, even if they don't. And secondly, you know, as a prototype pandemic preparedness platform, you know, everybody thought the next pandemic would be a flu or an influenza.
So these are samples from the Seattle Coronavirus Assessment Network.
We're interested in what's going on in the community with people who are infected with some respiratory pathogen. They're not sick enough to go to the doctor. What do they have, and can we find it? So when somebody signs up for the Seattle Flu Study, usually it's because, you know, they've woken up with some sort of illness. The person, you know, follows the instructions to swab themselves and put that swab safely in a tube in a specimen bag. We test it for COVID and 20-something other pathogens. We found out about coronavirus just like everybody else through the news. We immediately saw that, hey, if we just turn on a test for coronavirus at the same time, we could be screening for all of these things to understand what coronavirus looks like in the community right now. There was already a massive outbreak in Europe. There was kind of no way that it wasn't here already. We just weren't looking. So it was really not surprising at all. And we found one within the first 400 samples we ran.
The results of the sequencing that labs like Leah's get go into bigger systems that then feed into a program called NextStrain. That was created by Trevor Bedford.
So tell us what we're looking at here.
Oh boy. So here we can see the viruses that were collected over the course of the pandemic.
Trevor's work focuses on where mutations are and how they spread around the world. And it's work that he's done for other diseases, particularly flu. And that's part of the work that gets done to like help build the new flu shots. And also work that's been adapted to tuberculosis, Ebola, even Zika. So it's the kind of genomic and scientific sequencing data taken to the next level and shown in that real world, here's where the threats are, here's where the virus is emerging kind of way.
So there's many countries, many geographies that didn't have any sequencing, and now they're sequencing thousands of viruses every month. And this is a huge step into the future. How this whole thing works, how this genomic surveillance works, is that right now people will get tested for coronavirus. Each of those swabs will result in a 30,000 letter genome. And so each of the samples will have slightly different mutations in those 30,000 letters. and can use that to look for variants that are emerging and how they're spreading and kind of learn a lot about both the evolution and epidemiology of the virus. So this is viruses that are currently circulating that were collected from the very early pandemic. So this is going to be Wuhan. In January 2020, the first sequencing was really helpful to establish human-to-human spread. So this was at a time when China was downplaying human-to-human spread, but Chinese scientists were openly sharing their sequencing data. And after that point, the sequencing was really helpful to understand how it was spreading around the world. And then subsequent, it's been really helpful to understand variants and their spread and whether one virus is more transmissible than another virus. Basically, if we can get the whole world to be having the ability to detect and sequence COVID, it would give us a head start in terms of when the next pandemic is emerging, as it could emerge from anywhere.
My intentions are, and to the extent that I could have any influence on it, there will be a broad, comprehensive approach to pandemic preparedness and response at every level.
I mean, there have been calls recently for increased pandemic preparedness and building more capacity. One might imagine in a future where there's a lot of great, you know, respiratory disease surveillance, people having a swab in their home, and when they got that cough, they would, you know, swab themselves and then send that back to the lab and they could test for multiple pathogens. That would make a big difference. My goal is to try to make this stuff a heck of a lot cheaper so that we can kind of perform this sort of surveillance without breaking the bank like we've been doing for the last couple of years. I'm just worried that before we can build something like that on a national scale, the political will evaporate and the appropriations will evaporate with it.
It's the work that's going on when there's not a pandemic that really prepares us for pandemics. And that probably sounds fairly obvious, but it's really important to stop and realize that we don't always fund that research. For us to be really prepared and building better vaccines that protect us against threats that exist, we really need to be paying for basic research to be going on all the time. Without this kind of funding, so much amazing scientific work could sit on shelf. That's really unfortunate.
Scientists in South Africa are warning of a new strain of COVID-19. The variant, which is yet to be named, appears to have a high number of mutations.
In the weeks after going to Seattle, Omicron emerged, and it's remarkable when you think about the speed at which the information about Omicron was made available. Had we not been sequencing and had we not discovered Omicron, we would have just experienced a surge in COVID cases with no reason, and we would have had no understanding about that. And the reason some of this is possible is because of private money, actually, in public health.
Hi, Rick.
There you are. Welcome to us.
Rick Bright worked in government in several different positions. He was a whistleblower under the Trump administration. He came out publicly to air his concerns about how the Trump administration was handling pandemic preparedness.
Our economy is spiraling downward, and our population is being paralyzed by fear, stemming from a lack of a coordinated response and a dearth of accurate, clear communication about the path forward.
But he's since rejoined the Biden COVID transition team and now is part of the Rockefeller Foundation, and he's heading up their Pandemic Preparedness Institute.
I think governments move slowly. They want to check and double check. They want to, you know, evaluate things. And they want to be absolutely certain before they pull those triggers. And I saw that with the MERS outbreak, with the H1N1 influenza outbreak, with the Zika outbreak. We've seen this repeatedly. We need to have entities in place and organizations in place in our country that can be less risk averse, that can be more nimble and flexible, so the world can know what's happening and scientists and the public can be able to better respond to those newly emerging variants.
Do we have enough sequencing? And is it rapid enough for us to be able to enact public health measures to really stem the tide of another wave of serious infections?
Genomic surveillance alone can't do much. But genomic surveillance and sequencing data is a powerful data set that we can use to target resources to areas where we know there will be a surge in virus, to bolster the hospital systems, to make sure there are sufficient medical supplies in those areas where we might see that virus emerging. Genomic surveillance is a powerful leading indicator that will allow us to target our medical countermeasures and our healthcare response.
The Biden administration announced $1.7 billion for improved sequencing data sharing. Is it enough money? Do we need more money to really build the kind of systems that we would say really have put the safeguards in place that we need?
You know, it was a lot of money. I don't think the money has been distributed fully. I don't think it's being distributed fast enough. And we will be fighting this pandemic in the rearview mirror until we get in front of a solid, robust surveillance system that will also target vaccine breakthrough and reinfection cases. Our vaccines are amazing. They're wonderful. They're doing a wonderful job until they don't. And it's in those few cases when they don't where we really need to harness that genomic surveillance capability to ask why. We've made a lot of progress. Don't discount that at all. My biggest concern, though, Cynthia, is all of these things that we've learned, even the things that we've done to make improvements, could just as easily be forgotten the day after this pandemic ends. We need to make sure that we're taking every step to dig in and implement these new things that we're learning for a new normal going forward beyond the pandemic.
Are we more prepared? Yes and no. I think we know what we need to do, and that's, you know, half the battle at least. We know that we need to be stockpiling supplies to build tests. We know that testing is really important. We know that surveillance is really important, but I am not sure that we're going to be able to do that in a nimble fashion, but I think science is ready.
There are reasons to be optimistic when you think about pandemic preparedness now as compared to 2 years ago. I think we do have a lot more sequencing capability in the US and in the world than we did previously, and a lot more of the scientific work is getting done. But probably what's critically missing here is the sustainability of funding. And I think the other thing that we really need to consider and make sure that is constantly in this conversation is the benefits of sequencing are tailoring the vaccine to make sure that it's more effective. So we need sequencing going on all over the world, but we need the benefits of that sequencing to also flow through to the people who are providing that scientific information, that those countries are also getting the vaccine and making sure that it really benefits the whole world, not just a small sliver.